10 is...
Take 1 minute each for this one.
Sure.
1 minute each.
He so poorly researches issues. I have been opposed to Rockville and drug laws ever since I was the first district attorney in this state to have drug treatment as an alternative to the prison. I don't know who tells you these things about prosecuting young African-American kids for low amounts of marijuana. We dismiss 71% of them to come into our system. There are 3,000 convicted of violations. And by the way, Ken, in the state system, a violation is not a crime.
I know that.
Therefore, excuse me.
I know that.
I didn't interrupt you, and therefore, the file is sealed. So what really happens is of the 14,000 that are arrested each year, 13,000 have their cases sealed.
Let me just say this. He misses the point. He misses the point. The point isn't when they come into the system, oh, he's dismissing them. The point is they should have never been coming into the system in the first place. This is the point that he gets. I'm not sure if people in Breezy Point are being arrested for having low amounts of marijuana on them, but the people in Brownsville, Bed-Stuy, and East New York are. And what I want to do is I want to deal with the increase in rapes in Brooklyn. I want to deal with the increase in murders in South Brooklyn. I want to deal with the increased felony assaults in South Brooklyn. And you know what happened on Friday? Right down the street from where I live, three young men in Fort Greene Park were shot. Two were killed. And on Sunday, I stood outside that park with the mother of one of the victims. He was only 21 years old. She had tears in her eyes. Now, what should I tell that mother? Should I tell that mother that we should continue to devote millions of dollars and millions of police hours to go after marijuana arrests? Or should we fight to get these guns off the street and save the lives of our children? That's what I want to do. That's the difference between me and him.
That's a perfect segue into the next question.
I like it, answer. No, I didn't act as a chance to answer that, though.
We're going to move on to the next question, and you'll have a chance to answer very shortly. What, as the top law enforcement official in Brooklyn, the DA, what should the relationship with the police be? So when you talk about these crimes that you'd like to deal with, how would you do that as DA? And how would you interact with the police to make sure that you're getting the sort of results you're looking for? Not just with marijuana arrests now, but with murders, rapes, other crimes?
Well, let me just say this. I want to make it absolutely clear so no one can distort my position. I support the police. I was raised by a single mother who was one of the first women to go on patrol in the history of the city. Had it not been for the police department, I wouldn't be sitting here. Because I had a strong mother who fought to get us out of the projects. But I also understand that at times when, first of all, the police are hardworking, dedicated. They put their lives on the line to keep us safe. We know that, and I support that. But there are times when the police, some, cross the line. Like in the Abner Luima case, when I was a federal prosecutor. I'm the one who stood up and delivered the opening statement that got Justin Volpe convicted and sentenced to 30 years in prison. But here's the situation. The relationship between the police and the community has to be based on trust. And when you have young men being stopped and tossed on the streets of Brooklyn who have done nothing wrong, you deteriorate that trust. And then we expect the people from those communities to come into our court system, serve on juries, and believe cops. You see, there are collateral consequences to the stop and frisk madness. The collateral consequences are when jurors have great suspicion of cops, they don't convict when there's solid evidence to convict. And guess what? Where's his record on police prosecuting cops who do wrong? Right in my neighborhood, right across the street from Lafayette Gardens, what happened? Shep Walker was killed in 2009, right there on Lafayette Avenue. He came outside, saw somebody sitting on his mother's steps of her brownstone, and told that person to leave. He didn't know he was an undercover cop. They started fighting. And that undercover cop pulled out a gun and shot him three times. Now, that happened in July 2009. If that was a good shooting, this DA has an obligation to clear that cop. And if it was a bad shooting, he has an obligation to prosecute him. But what he has chosen to do is to do nothing. We can't have that because the community and the police involved need to know the truth. That's the difference between me and him. I will act. I will support the police when they do right, and I will prosecute them when they do wrong. Failure to do anything is not an option anymore in Brooklyn.
I'm going to deal with someone, my hand is so widely,
Can't hear you.
I know the mic is off.
Testing.
Okay, good. It's very difficult to pick and choose, to answer the blunderbuss approach that Mr. Thompson uses. But take a few. People should be, cops should be stopped from making bad arrests from the beginning. Well, what does he do about that? He has no answer. He still hasn't told us what he would do about stop and frisk. And you know, did you hear about the gun program? We have to do things about getting guns off the street. Do you hear what his answer was, you know? Special programs to get the guns off. In March of last year, he showed up at a church. We were doing, it was our 30th gun buyback program. And Ray Kelly and I paid $200 in return for a workable gun. Shows up at church, it's a great fanfare, talks about guns for greatness. I'm going to assign a mentor to each kid who brings a gun here today. And that kid is going to be helped educationally and help in his work record. And the next day, we're out at the One Police Plaza, and Ray Kelly and I are showing the guns that we paid for the day before, and in comes Thompson, repeats this stuff about guns for greatness, and he's never done a single thing to go forward. Now, when I was pressing him last night, he wouldn't answer. He was dissembling. And I said, well, answer the question. Why didn't you follow up? He said, I had a gun buyback program in Queens, and the NYPD canceled it. Well, good God, if he can't manage one gun buyback program, how in the hell is he going to produce anything of significant policy in the other end of the agency?
I know you write books of fiction, but this is not a time for fiction. This is the time for the truth. And let me explain something. He said that I was part of a gun buyback program last year. That is completely false.
Last March.
What happened is this. Let me set the record straight, because you know what? Last night on New York One, I didn't get a chance to really break it down. But I'm going to break it down right now. I'm a lawyer in private practice. I'm not the Brooklyn DA yet. So as a lawyer in private practice, you know what I did? I worked with young men in the entertainment industry who came to me. And they said, we have a program called Guns for Greatness where we want to get young men of color in Brownsville and Eastern New York to stop killing each other and turning their guns. So they came to me and I drafted their legislation, drafted their proposal, and gave it to Police Commissioner Kelly and helped launch Guns for Greatness. Guns for Greatness was funded by private sector money. I put it together with Blue Williams and others. We held it at Christian Cultural Center on March 30th. We got 115 guns submitted in 6 hours. D.A. Hynes had zero to do with it, but he did walk in with his deputy campaign manager to church that day. And so when we had a successful program, he had never reached out, as far as I know, to the private sector like I did. See, that takes a level of innovation that we need. So he can't.
Why do you lie repeatedly? You know damn well at the cultural center, I was there with Ray Kelly. You were there with Ray Kelly, and Kelly and I were paying for the guns. Why would you lie like that? And, you know, let's get back to all this.
Well, you have to be civil
if you don't mind.
You have to be civil here. It's important.
Be civil. I don't think you understand what the word means. Now about. Arresting all these children, all these kids. Very good. Are these folks you trained to act like that?
Trained.
All of these. About all of these terrible things I do to young kids of color. The problem is he's so desperate that 20 major African American and Latino legislators, state and city, as well as district leaders, support me and not him. And that's what he's concerned about.
You know how many of the folks who stood with him publicly have come to me and said they want me to win? But I'm not going to go there. Let's deal with the people who's supporting me. Let's deal with Congressman Hakeem Jeffries, who supports me. Let's deal with Congresswoman Lydia Velasquez, who supports me. Let's deal with Gerald Nadler, who supports me. Let's deal with Yvette Clark, who supports me.
We want to ask about some of the issues, so we're going to move on to the next question, and then, again, you guys, I'm sure, will continue. So this one is going to come from Donna Vasquez of the No Condoms as Evidence Coalition. Are you in? Come on, please.
everybody doing?
Very well.
Well, my name is Crystal Sheridan. I'm America's sales director. And I am here today on behalf of No Condoms as Evidence Coalition. And this topic is very important to me, which I need these two nice gentlemen here in the front to help us out too at the same time. And the current policy of this Brooklyn's DA office states that possession of condoms will not be used as evidence of intent to engage in prostitution. However, people may still be discouraged from carrying condoms, and that's a disgrace right now, or having them on the premises because they can be used as evidence of other prostitution-related offense. Me, I'm Crystal Sheridan, Mary Kay Sales Director. I woke up at 5 o'clock in the morning one day, went getting dressed, and I was on my way to work to my office at 14 Wall Street, and yes, I'm a transgender too. And I had like two condoms. I had two condoms, which I regret to this day right now carrying. In my Mary Kay bag, which I carry right there, is a big old bag. And at the same time, an officer posing as a client, thinking that I'm a prostitute, asked me how much. I told him, excuse me. I was like, can you see the uniform I'm wearing? Can you see the shoes I wear? Can you see the bag, what company it represents? Can you see who I am? At the same time, he said, turn around, let's go. I'm like, what am I being arrested for? He said, let me see the bag. I'm like, go ahead and try some makeup on too, because I think you need it. Well, anyway, at the same time, he checked my bag. He saw two condoms. This is not the first time that I've been arrested for carrying condoms, although this is like my third time, and this is so ridiculous right now of every person, you know, and at the same time, I'm a professional, and at the same time, right now, they torture me, they beat me, they smack me all around, and yes, I'm doing something about it too. At the same time, I informed my company, Mary Kay, and they are willing to help out all the LGBTs who has this problem. And at the same time, I wanna know, do you support continuing this policy and extending protection to youth and victims of trafficking by fully eliminating the use of condoms as evidence for all prostitution-related offenses? And this is very important for me, and I would like a good answer too.
Yes.
Please, okay, because this has to end now. Thank you.
I take it you were arrested in New York County at that point you were talking about?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm the only district attorney in the city that has told the police commissioner, stop picking up condoms for evidence, because I'm not going to use them.
Once again, it's double standard Joe. At one point, he used condoms as evidence, but now, He's in a fight of his life to stay in office, and all of a sudden he's against it. See, we need a prosecutor who's not going to basically make decisions based on whichever way the wind is blowing. Of course, we shouldn't use condoms as evidence, because what that does, it undermines public health. We want people to use condoms. We want to make sure that people do not catch diseases. There's a better way for law enforcement to go about doing its job without jeopardizing the public health of the citizens of Brooklyn and in New York City. And this is such an important issue. You can't flip-flop on whether you're going to use condoms evidence the way he did. You see, at the end of the day, you have to look at a person's record. You can't just look at when they're running for office. Look at his record. Look at what he has done. Because that's the Joe Hynes you have to deal with. That's the Joe Hynes that we can no longer have for another 4 years. That's the Joe Hynes who's going to allow a prosecutor to call prostitutes from his office and not lift his finger to fire him. How many of you would do that? None would do that. And so you can't let somebody like Joe Hynes have a double standard of justice as DA. We need someone who's going to have one standard of justice for all.
I was approached by a group of advocates last year and asked about the condom policy, and I told them we do not use condoms for evidence, so I don't know where he gets the idea of this flip-flopping. But again, it's a matter of not being up to speed, not having any research. I'm very, very proud of what we've done here in Brooklyn. You know, we've had an 80% reduction in serious crimes since I had the privilege of becoming DA. And I didn't do it by being a tough guy. Did he really think I was going to turn to a kid, a barely out of law school, did something so profoundly stupid as to call a prostitute and to fire the kid? Is that the kind of DA you want? You want someone with no compassion at all? That's what you want? Vote for him. But I said to the kid, you're suspended without pay, and you're going to go to a sex counselor, and you're going to pay out of your own pocket. That kid recently resigned from the office.
Well, this is a fact. This is a fact. That young kid that he refers to resigned last week because a newspaper article came out. See, what we have to have in the Brooklyn DA's office...
Because he was a stand-up young man.
We have to have integrity in the Brooklyn DA's office. Here's a man who has no hesitation to prosecute people who solicit prostitutes outside the office. But he will not fire on the spot one of his own prosecutors who's calling prostitutes from work. I mean, that person was on his staff 4 years after that happened. And I can tell you, if anyone in my law firm was caught calling prostitutes and I confirmed that they did it, they would be fired right on the spot. Not allowed to resign 3 years later when I'm running for office and I need cover.
So we move on to the next question. Political corruption has been rampant throughout the state and often in Brooklyn. Political corruption has been rampant throughout the state and often in Brooklyn. What would what should and what has the office done to try to limit it?
Well, let me just say this. Here's the truth. Joe Hynes has outsourced political corruption cases to the feds. He's outsourced it. He's been on the sideline while federal prosecutors have brought the cases over the last 10 years. And you know why? Because he's so too close to the Democratic machine here in Brooklyn. He has compromised his position. He is not able to protect the people of Brooklyn from public corruption because his good friend is Vito Lopez. And we know, I don't call him Vito Lopez a good man. He called him a good man. He vouched for Vito Lopez as a sitting DA. He called that man, Vito Lopez, a good man. Now, we all know Vito Lopez was the county leader here in Brooklyn, a very powerful man. But we all read the report that came out of the Albany about what this good man did to innocent women who worked for him, how he degraded and sexually harassed the women on his staff. I want this DA to ask those women who were degraded and sexually harassed if they think Vito Lopez is a good man. And when he had an opportunity to investigate Vito Lopez, he passed up that opportunity. And guess what he did? He did it the Friday before Labor Day. Sleight of hands. What he did is he sent that investigation to Dan Donovan, who represents the smallest borough in the city. Shouldn't we here in Brooklyn have an opportunity to have Vito Lopez investigated here in Brooklyn? Should we have to farm that out to the Staten Island DA? And he said the reason why he couldn't investigate his good buddy Vito Lopez is because they were too close. Vito supported him. His daughter used to work for Vito. He is compromised. And you know what? I'm not supported by the Democratic County machine here. I'm running as an independent because the prosecutor has to be independent and not like him. That's why it's been completely silent in the Brooklyn DA's office over the last 10 years. He's going to talk about, oh, I went after Clarence Foreman. I went after these judges. How many years ago was that? The last thing I'm going to say is I'm going to bring the FBI to the Brooklyn DA's office. But see, this is the problem. This is not a game. The future of Brooklyn is at stake, and he's treating this as a game. He should be ashamed of it. Let's finish this point. The point I'm making to you is the point I want to make is this. The FBI goes around the country, and they train local prosecutors on how to conduct public corruption investigations if they're asked. I intend to ask the FBI to come to Brooklyn to the U.S. Attorney's Office once I went to train my staff on how to conduct public corruption investigation. I'm going to double the size of the unit. I'm going to add more prosecutors. I'm going to add more investigators. Because if you serve as a public official in Brooklyn, you must serve with honor. And if
thank
you don't,
you.
I
thank
will prosecute you.
Harry, how many times are we going to allow him to go over this time? Heaven's sake. And you know, he's misleading you. Would you listen to me for a second? He either doesn't know the law of appointing a special DA, or he knows he's trying to deceive you. I didn't pick Dan Donovan to investigate Vito Lopez, who is not my friend. I didn't pick Dan Donovan. The administrative judge for the Supreme Court picked Dan Donovan after I submitted papers and said, look, Lopez supported me as the county chairman in 09. He was supporting me in 2013. It would be inappropriate for me to investigate him. Yeah, my daughter did work for 10 years ago as a social worker. But don't be deceived by this nonsense. The selection was made by the judge. You want to talk about political corruption, but first of all, he has no connection with political corruption at any part of his career, other than, you know, being hired by the state senate and Pedro Espada to block an inspector general's investigation in the state senate. And then, you know, he gets $118,000 of public money for losing a motion to quash a subpoena. I convicted the county chairman of Brooklyn, two other, and another corrupt assembly member, and three judges. I sent four of them to prison, and two other cases I indicted and prosecuted before I became the district attorney. I have convicted more legislators and more judges than any state prosecutor in the history of New York State, and that's a fact.
Let me say this. Hold on. Some of them are clean, some of them are clearly aimed at one candidate. This one's for you. When you represented Dominique Strauss-Kahn's accuser, you held press conferences and demanded aggressive prosecution before all the facts were in. Don't you think that you showed the same insensitivity to defendants' rights that you're accusing DA Hynes of in this campaign?
Absolutely not, and let me tell you why. I represented the physical Diallo, and I'm proud of my representation of her. She came to this country from the west shores of Africa for a better life. She came here to pursue the great promise of America, and she should have been allowed to do that. She got a job cleaning up hotel rooms in the Sofitel Hotel and did it for years and never had a problem until she walked into Dominique Strauss-Kahn's hotel room. And when she came out, her life was in shambles. And guess what? She was going against one of the most powerful men in the world. She was going against the head of the International Monetary Fund. She was going against the next president of France, and she needed a strong advocate, and that's what I gave her. And at the end of the day, when she was being pilloried and destroyed in the media, being called horrible names, extortionists, con artists, she needed somebody to set the record straight. And that's what I did. And I stood up with her when the Manhattan district attorney dismissed that case. I did not abandon Ms. Diallo. I stood by her and I sued Dominique Strauss-Kahn in the Bronx State Supreme Court. And Dominique Strauss-Kahn settled that case months ago. And now Ms. Diallo is putting the pieces of her life back together. And what has happened to Dominique Strauss-Kahn since he went back over across the pond? What happened? Dominique Strauss-Kahn is about to be prosecuted himself. So at the end of the day, they want to point to Dominique Strauss-Kahn as if this is like, I'm sorry, a grandstanding type of attorney. They don't tell you about all the women, the pregnant women who are represented, who've been discriminated against because they were having a child. They don't tell you about the people who are represented who have cancer, who got fired because they needed to go for treatment and take time off from work. They don't tell you about the people I represented who were discriminated against because they needed to observe the Sabbath. They don't tell you about all the gay women, men and women I represent who've been discriminated against based on their sexual orientation. And with respect to that Senate representation, I have a law firm on Fifth Avenue and 16th Street. We have a prominent law firm. Prominent law firms represent all types of people. And guess what? He brings up Pedro Espada. That's some type of badge of shame. I've never met Pedro Espada a day in my life, and he knows it.
Mm-hmm. You want to take any time on this?
Where would I begin? You know, the worst part of it, you all know how to use Google, right? Young Dems? Google Thompson in that case. Google it and find out that he was having daily press conferences accusing the Manhattan District Attorney of being unethical and corrupt while he's looking at the facts of the case that was brought to him. Just look it up. You know, you don't have to listen to me. You know, he tells so many stories. He tells, by the way, a great story about his mom, and she must be one terrific lady. First cop on patrol as a woman, raised him and his siblings. Well, I had a mother, too. My mother was a victim of domestic violence. And I did something about that. When I became DA in 1990, I became the first district attorney to have a full-size domestic violence bureau. And today, with the Family Justice Center, we have the most comprehensive domestic violence containment program of any place in this country, and it's dedicated to my mother's memory. That's what I did for my mother.
Case. There's no need to relitigate it. But when you do that Google search that he asked you to do, you'll have to look far and wide to see daily press conferences I held. What I did was, I stood in front of the courthouse and I demanded that Nafissatou Diallo receive what they taught me at NYU Law School, and that is equal justice and equal protection under the law. And I asked the Manhattan District Attorney to stand by that victim the way I stood by Admiral Owima. We all know what happened to Admiral Owima. When he was dragged into the bathroom of the 78th precinct and sodomized with a broken broomstick, who stood up for him? I did. And when we learned that he had said something that wasn't true before trial, did we abandon him? No. Remember when he said, as they were holding him down, they said, it's Giuliani time, not Dinkins time? That wasn't true. And when we found out it wasn't true, did we abandon him? No, because the evidence showed he was tortured in that bathroom. The evidence against Nafissatou Diallo in terms of what happened in that hotel room never changed. So I stood by her then, and I stand by her today. Like I stand by the people of Brooklyn.
Thank you.
Call it like I see it.
And again, I ask you to turn to Google. And look at the case involving Abdul Owima and see who had an indictment against that thuggish cop and his two cohorts within a week after Abdul Owima was violated. It was me. I prosecuted the Owima case right now. He never gives me any credit for it, of course. But his boss, Zach Carter, and I are very good friends. And when I found that the maximum punishment could only be 12 and a half years for Volpe and what he did to Abdul Owima, I called Zach Carter. And I said, what's the penalty in the federal system? He said, it could be up to life. And I said, okay, Zach, I'm going to withdraw from the case. I dismissed the charges. Zach Carter had a press conference in his office. Commended me for turning over that case for the right reason, that Volpe would receive the kind of justice he demands. And Mr. Thompson keeps telling you about giving an opening statement. You know, a couple of my students are in the audience. I've been teaching trial advocacy for 25 years. You could teach an automaton how to make an opening statement. He didn't get the cross-examination or the summation.
This is the fact about that Owima case. He did indict the state case. He did that, that's a fact. But he handed it over to the feds to carry it through. And it fell to me to carry it through, not just by doing an opening statement. I cross-examined, I put the case in the grand jury. I was one of the prosecutors from day one. Now, his argument is true that he gave over that case because it had tough, stiffer penalties. Then why don't you give the feds all your police brutality cases? Now, let me ask you something.
No, no,
why don't you
pan this
some more?
We're going to the next.
Go ahead.
Please, thank you.
Good.
You
want to
respond?
Huh?
No.
Yes.
It's not worth responding
to.
So the next question is for you, man.
Sure.
John O'Hara and Vito Lopez have committed the same residency crime. Why is only one O'Hara, who may have just been that laughing voice, been punished? Been prosecuted.
The O'Hara case was sent to me by the Board of Elections many, many years ago. In fact, he did violate the residency law. In fact, he was prosecuted. In fact, he was convicted of a felony, and he's still a convicted felon. Lopez, no information was brought to me about his violating the residency law, and I already told you, because of things that should be objectively clear, I can prosecute crooked politicians. I've proven that over and over again. But I had an obligation to tell the Supreme Court judge who is in charge of the applications for recusal what the facts were, and she agreed, and she was the one who gave the case to Donovan.
This is another example of double standard Joe. Let's look at what he did to John O'Hara, and let's look at who is the head of his conviction integrity unit. The head of his conviction integrity unit lives in New Jersey in violation of the law. And Joe Hynes knows that, and he will not apply that law to his own prosecutor, because if you're in with Joe, then you get a pass. And if you challenge him or you challenge any of his political allies, then you have problems. We know that. Now, I believe that what the appellate division said, the Character Fitness Committee said, that John O'Hara was the victim of a political hit by the machine carried out by this DA. But I don't want to focus solely on John O'Hara. I want to focus on Judge John Phillips. Please do me a favor. This is very important. When you go home, since he's giving you homework to do on Google, let me give you some as well. Google the name Judge John Phillips and learn about how this African-American former judge, who was a multi-millionaire, he had $10 million in assets in Brooklyn. He had multiple buildings. He owned the Slade Theater on Fulton Street. But he did something that he would pay a dear price for. He decided to challenge Joe Hynes for DA in 2001. And guess what? Joe Hynes had him declared mentally incompetent. And guess what? His former chief of staff ended up being Judge Phillips' guardian. And you know what happened? It was guardian after guardian. And Judge Phillips ended up dying broke and destitute, and all of his properties were taken away. If you don't believe me, drive by the Slave Theater right now and you'll see it boarded up. And so now, how is it possible that a wealthy man was ended up being put under guardianship and had Joe Hynes, his former chief of staff, and his, I believe, his campaign treasurer as his guardian? How is that possible? At the end of the day, Judge Phillips deserve justice. Please Google Judge Phillips and see how he treats people who want to challenge him on top of Sandra Roper and John O'Hara.
He mentioned Sandra Roper yesterday. She was indicted for stealing $12,000 from a client. I didn't prosecute her. Because she'd run against me, I did what I had to do, and I asked for a special DA. A special DA was appointed. And Sandra Roper's case eventually was settled out. But he said last night, I prosecuted Roper. Just nonsense. Judge Phillips never ran against me. Never filed or got a single petition signature. And this guy goes on and raves about those kind of things. Look, you have an absolute right to run against me. I never quarrel with that. But for heaven's sake, get the facts straight once. By the way, if I did all these horrible things to this African-American judge, why in the name of God would every major black leader support me for district attorney? Very simple. Because I brought public safety to Brooklyn without penalizing young black kids. That's why.
Let me just say this. Last time I checked, Hakeem Jeffries is African-American, and he's a major leader in this city and in this borough. Now, Joe, you didn't answer the question. How did Judge Phillips go from having $10 million in assets, and then when you put him under this guardianship by your former chief of staff, he ended up dying broke, destitute, in a nursing home? How did that happen, Joe?
I have no authority to appoint a guardian. You understand? Why would he sit here and lie to you? And you've got to figure that out, for heaven's sake. If you want him to be the law enforcement officer in this county, he's got to tell the truth.
Let me just say this last point. He has an obligation to investigate criminal acts that occur in Brooklyn. When he basically worked it out so Judge Phillips had to be put under guardianship,
not true.
What happened is all of those guardians failed, or most of them failed to do what they were supposed to do with the filing income taxes. And one, I believe, was accused of taking money from his estate. Did Joe Hynes ever investigate any of them? And he said he did it to help Judge Phillips. Well, he died destitute, Joe. He died broke, Joe. He died in a nursing home, and you did nothing to help him.
Folks,
let's keep it real. Let's be honest here. It's important.
No, you're not telling the truth.
You abuse your power against Judge Phillips like you did against John O'Hara, like you did against Sandra Roper. While you give day after day.
Why would you repeat Sandra Roper when we've just corrected the record that I did not prosecute her? Why would you do that?
Who started the investigation, Joe?
I didn't start it. I immediately sent it to a special prosecutor with an application to the judge.
Well, you know, people who run against you or want to run against you sort of end up dead, broke, or indicted.
He is just downright disrespectful, unprofessional, and irrational. Well, you only got one of us to pick, my dear.
So, I think where are we? We've got actually half an hour of time left, so I'm going to ask two more of these audience questions while the lighting on and then both of you will close. So, this next one is, earlier this week, the Attorney General, Eric Holder, announced a plan to end over-incarceration by having prosecutors essentially short-circuit the mandatory minimum sentencing laws for many drug offenses. What have both of you done to help put Brooklyn at the forefront of this movement and mass incarceration?
Well, what I'm going to do when I get in, I'm going to deal with the issue of mass incarceration, first of all, by making sure that we can reduce the number of people who come into the criminal justice system in the first place. I think that's important. I think that we need to have a prosecutor that's going to devise programs to try to keep these young men and women from coming into the criminal justice system. And I commend Joe Hynes for creating some of his programs back in 1990 when it was innovative. But it's 2013 now, and we need to have new programs. And the new programs that we need to have, for instance, there's a program in Seattle called LEAD. It's in the Belltown section of Seattle where drug offenders, nonviolent drug offenders, it's a pilot program where they're not taken into the criminal justice system, but the police have an option to take them directly to drug treatment before they come into the criminal justice system. I think that's innovative. I think that's something that we need to look at. And I also think that when you deal with mass incarceration, you can't get past stop and frisk. You can't get past the fact that these young men of color have been prosecuted unjustly for small amounts of marijuana, because guess what? Once they have that criminal record, then since they will have trouble getting employment later, it's almost as if we inadvertently put them on a path to criminal activity. So I think that we can deal with the sentencing laws, but let's get to people before they come into the criminal justice system. And that's what I want to do.
He has no authority to do that. Listen very carefully. He wants to stop people from coming into the criminal justice system. He cannot do that unless he's the mayor or the police commissioner. But I can do it. But I have to. I have done in thousands of cases is I have diverted kids out of the criminal justice system with alternative programs. Now, you talk about the lead program in Seattle. It's a great idea. But, Mike, I've been doing that with young prostitutes since 2004, giving them social services.
Sex workers.
Oh, sure. And I have been doing that for adult sex workers since 2005, giving them help. You know, he mentioned before about, you know, locking up Johns. We have a John school. We've had 3,000 people go through the John school. We've had 30 rearrested. So it's been very, very successful. I believe in the kind of programs that divert people out of the criminal justice system. And what I have been doing all through my career, doing things with the formerly incarcerated, making very sure that they don't get re-incarcerated. And I've been fighting to the front to expand that program, and I hope if I have the opportunity to get reelected and do this again, I'm going to expand that program to everyone coming home from the prisons so we can reduce crime again.
Again, he misses the point. He said that as DA, I would not be able to stop people from coming into the criminal justice system. Well, guess what? I think I can. And let me give you a couple of examples of how. Gun violence is literally killing our children right before our very eyes. From Brownsville to East New York to Chicago to New Orleans, we have to do something about the guns. And I intend to do something about the guns. Because before I became a federal prosecutor, I worked for President Clinton's Treasury Department. I was an attorney there. And I worked very closely with the ATF. I worked with the ATF when those ATF agents were murdered in Waco, Texas by David Koresh. The ATF has got to do a better job of interdicting these guns. These guns are not made in Brooklyn. They come up from Virginia and other southern states. Now, there are groups right here in Brooklyn that are on the ground to stop these young men from shooting and killing each other. One is Man Up in East New York. As DA, I want to partner with Man Up. I don't want to just stand at the courthouse door waiting for the prisoners to come in. I want to go into the community and work with Man Up, because when they hear about a beef, they're on the streets trying to dispel that beef before they pull out those guns and start shooting. That's how you can prevent people from coming into the system.
I hate to get back to a terribly embarrassing situation for him, but he hasn't done a damn thing about guns, for goodness, ever since he had his press conference. I've taken 2,837 case guns off the streets of Brooklyn since my church buyback started in 2008. But more importantly, all of my colleagues have replicated my program. So in sum, we've taken 11,000 guns off the streets of New York City. And I've not heard Ken Thompson say that that's a good program. I would support it, because he's got guns for greatness, which is a myth.
Let me just say this. I helped launch Guns for Greatness, as I said before. It is not my program. I helped them get it off the ground. It came to me. I wrote the proposal.
And then you washed your hands of it.
And then,
but the difference,
can I finish? The difference between me and him is, he said this just a week or so ago, that his gun buyback programs are not targeting young criminals with guns. He said it. The Daily News, about 2 weeks ago, they had a press conference on a Sunday in City Hall, at the City Council, announcing the $300,000 that's going to be given a gun buyback program. And he told the Daily News, I'm not targeting young criminals with guns. I'm targeting older folks who have guns hidden in their homes and cars. That's the difference between Joe Hynes and me. I want to target the young men on the streets who are killing people with those guns. And so the Guns for Greatness program that I helped launch literally targeted these young men. We went on Hot 97 and promoted it. We promoted it in the Source magazine, because we've got to get into the community and get to those young guys who don't necessarily respond to his gun buyback programs. We have to be innovative here. There's no panacea for this gun violence. But for him to try to criticize me, a private citizen who got 115 guns off the street in 6 hours.
And you didn't pay a nickel for them. I paid for all the guns. Kelly and I paid for the guns.
I may have.
We paid for the guns.
No, it's my federal forfeiture money, not your money. Anyway, I just hate to embarrass him. You know, he creates this wonderful program. He puts the design in place, and he can't get it implemented, so he walks away. That's your deal.
Next question.
Well, no, let me go back to this question. Why don't we take 1 minute and talk about whether or not we have over-incarceration and what you would do about it, and or have done about it, if so. But that, exactly that.
Well, you can't ask him. He's not the deal. I'll tell you what I've been doing. I believe we over-criminalize. It's a terrible thing, and I've done something about it. With 40 programs that did not exist before 1990, every one of those programs is designed to reduce the incarceration rate, to reduce the criminalization. That's what's been my commitment. And despite that, I've been able to reduce serious crime by 80% and murders down from 760 down to under 150 last year for the first time since 1960. I'm committed to reversing over-criminalization. And I think Eric Holder's decision is long past due. Thank God he finally woke up.
I voted against you, and you can attack me like you've done for months. But I don't think you should attack the sitting, Attorney General of the United States of America and say
public
finally
official,
woke up.
I can say that
the bottom line is
the time is delayed too long.
The bottom line is this, what he does not want you to know is when he comes before you today, he's Mr. Champion. I'm going to deal with mass incarceration. I'm sure he's read, you know, the new Jim Crow back and forth 10 times. But the issue is this, you can't sit here today and say you're against mass incarceration and you're trying to keep people out of the system when he has prosecuted thousands upon thousands of young men for possessing small amounts of marijuana. That is a fact, and he can't deny it, no matter what he says.
And if a word of that was true, I would not have the support of people like Assemblywoman Robinson, the Perry, or the Moses, or the Mara, Abel Sam, Senator Attorney Governor Montgomery, Eric Adams, Eric Galan, Al Van, Leticia James, a host of African-American leaders who support me because I have saved so many kids.
You know what? If I was in office for 24 years, I think I would have support too. Because when you're so close to the political machine, of course the political machine is going to come together and support him.
Are you calling those people machine candidates?
I'm saying veto loans.
You're outrageous. We're calling those people of color.
Let me finish.
Machine candidates? You're outrageous.
Let me finish.
Aren't you calling Annette Robinson a machine politician?
Let me finish. I'm not calling Annette Robinson a machine.
You sure are.
Let me finish. We certainly know that your good buddy Vito Lopez is a machine politician. It is a machine politician who you have given, turned your blind eye to. What I'm saying is this. He's been in office for almost 24 years. What do you expect? You expect that he's going to have some endorsements. But it is extraordinary, I think, that four distinguished members of Congress who come from different backgrounds, Congressman Jeffries, Congressman Clark, Congresswoman Velasquez, Congressman Nadler, they come from different backgrounds, but they have one thing in common. They want him out. And so at the end of the day, I'm not going to sit here and trade my endorsements for his. It is a fact that Brooklyn needs a new DA. And if I sat up here and said that Joe Hynes never did anything good in those 23 years, I would be lying to you. I'm not going to say that. But what I'm going to say is time for a new DA. It's time for someone else to have a chance to run that office. Someone else who's going to build upon the programs that he started. Build upon them. Figure out ways to make them better. And devise other programs. That's what I tend to do.
The makeup is a shock to Ken Thompson. But the first time since I became district attorney, I have the support of the Democratic organization. The first time. In a contested race. In 1989, I didn't have their support. When Senator Roper ran against me, I didn't have their support. Obviously, after indicting the county chairman of Kings County in 2005, I didn't have their support. This is the first time I'm getting their support, and it's on the merits. And that's why I'm supported by all these people.
And let's go beyond the elected officials, and let's deal with the most powerful union in the city, 1199. 200,000 strong, 1199 has decided to endorse me. The working families parties, they've decided to endorse me. The Bay Ridge Democrats have endorsed me. Lambda has endorsed me. The Muslim Democrats of New York City have endorsed me. What do they all have in common? They want a new DA. They know that it's time for a new DA because we cannot have innocent people being convicted for murders that they didn't commit. Because when an innocent person goes to prison for a murder that they didn't commit, that person's life is destroyed. Their family's life is destroyed. And the guilty are left to remain among us. It is extraordinary that he has to review 50 tainted homicide cases. And he wants to throw Detective Scarsella under the bus. Detective Scarsella did not operate in a vacuum. He operated hand in hand with the DA's office. So you can't stand here and wrongfully convict people and then turn around and try to play Captain America and say that you're going to free them.
The time is up, right?
At the end of the day, you need somebody who's going to make sure that those prosecutors turn over exculpatory evidence.
Right.
Make sure those prosecutors do not...
In 23 years, I have sent detectives to institutions armed with a court order to release people who were wrongfully convicted by police testimony, civilian testimony, my DNA matches, and I brought them down to court. I didn't ask for motion practice. You could ask Barry Sheck from Innocent Project. And we had these people had the cases set aside, the convictions set aside, and released. The fellow he just tarnished before, John O'Mara, the head of the Conviction Integrity Unit, who convicted John Kennedy O'Hara. I didn't hire John. John's been in the office for 35 years. But to suggest in a scurrilous way that because he convicted O'Hara, on a case, by the way, is reviewed by every single court, including federal judge Jack Gleason, who found overwhelming evidence of O'Hara's guilt, that's the way he operates. If he doesn't, anything to pander, anything to be scurrilous, and that's just unfortunate. That's the guy you want to DA and vote for.
What I'm saying about Mr. O'Mara is simple. I'm not attacking his character or his credibility. All I'm saying is he has to follow the law. He lives in New Jersey. He's supposed to live in New York. He is the top prosecutor, and he does not care. Just like he didn't care that one of his guys were calling prostitutes from his office.
That's a mistake.
You have to care, you have to be fair, and you have to show him all the managerial experience he talks about. It seems to have failed him when it comes to O'Mara. It seems to have failed him when it comes to Mike Vecchione. It seems to have failed him when it comes to the guy who was calling prostitutes. So at the end of the day, it's not just about managerial experience. It's about sound judgment. Hello? You have to make tough decisions as DA.
Yeah.
I made tough decisions in DSK. I made tough decisions in Louima. I'll make tough decisions as Brooklyn DA. But I'm always going to call it like I see it. And I'm always going to do what I think is in the best interest of the people.
You know, I'm so reminded.
Hey, man, I've got to stop it there for a minute.
I'm so reminded of Daniel Patrick Moynihan, who said to a candidate running against him, "Who tells you these things? Don't you do your independent research? What kind of a lawyer are you?"
Let me tell you the type of lawyer I am. I'm the type of lawyer that went to NYU Law School, that made it from the projects to help write a report for a sitting president. I'm the type of lawyer who stood up countless times for people who have been discriminated against, who have been victims of police brutality, who have been victims of catastrophic explosions, like the two people in that Con Ed steam pipe explosion case. And it goes on and on and on. And I'm the type of lawyer who stood up for Emmett Till, who I wasn't even born when he was murdered. And I'm still fighting for justice for him. That's the type of lawyer I am, Joe.
So that brings us to our lightning round. We will start with the district attorney. Do you support the restoration of voting rights for people living on parole?
Absolutely.
Do you support the restoration of voting rights for people living on parole?
Yes.
Would you support ending criminal and civil penalties for possession of small amounts of marijuana?
Yes.
Eliminate. Of course I would.
Do you support removing syringe possession from the penal law as a means of ending syringe possession arrests and promoting HIV and hepatitis C prevention?
Yes.
Yes.
Do you support creating more pedestrian plazas and bike lanes in Brooklyn?
Whoa.
I don't know.
Slow down, please. Harry, slow down so I can hear you.
I agree with Joe Hynes on this one. That's one thing. Slow down. So we don't answer the wrong question.
Do you support creating more pedestrian plazas and bike lanes in Brooklyn to increase pedestrian safety?
Are you asking me as DA or as a citizen? I think bike lanes are great. I think more bikes are better.
I'm fine.
All right. I have not written the lightning round questions. Do you support Governor Cuomo's proposal to replicate New York City's public financing model for elections statewide?
Absolutely.
Yes.
All right. With that,
look how we agree. Hey, we may have a beer one of these days.
We could end it there, but I think we should have closing statements, and we have a bit of time. So I'm going to give each of you guys. Let's see where we're at. It's 8:18. Why don't we take as much as 4 minutes each? But I'm going to cut you off right quick.
No, I should sum up less.
It doesn't matter. I'll go first. Here's the situation. We are at a critical point in the history of Brooklyn. And the critical point is as follows. After 23 years of Joe Hynes serving as Brooklyn DA, it is simply time for a new DA. Joe Hynes has created programs to help drug-addicted people. in 1990, that was innovative. The reentry program that he created in the 90s, innovative. But it is 2013, and there are different issues that we're facing here in Brooklyn. The issue of stop and frisk was playing out right before his very eyes, and he stood silent when we needed leadership. All of those young men of color who were stopped and frisked unjustly on the streets of Brooklyn, it was wrong if it wasn't based on reasonable suspicion. And Judge Shira Shinlin said that their constitutional rights were violated. Joe Hynes had an obligation to do something about that, to deal with the police, and to make sure that he protected the rights of the people of Brooklyn, and he failed them. Now he'll say, oh, many of those people never came into the criminal justice system, but they were degraded, they were humiliated on the streets of Brooklyn, and he knew about it. And so now he's running for office, and now he's trying to make it seem like, oh, he's been against stop and frisk. I want you to please point to one public statement he made in 2011 opposing the excessive practice of stop and frisk. You can't find it. You don't hear him say anything about this. In addition, innocent people have gone to prison for murders that they didn't commit. David Ranta is a great example. Look at the Jabbar Collins case. Look at the Dula case. How is it possible that in the Dula case, four young men were arrested for supposedly raping and sexually assaulting someone, but the victim recanted a day after they were arrested? And he let his prosecutor go into the grand jury and indict them, even though they knew that the victim said that she wasn't raped. That's not justice. It is not justice. We deserve better. We cannot have prosecutors submitting forged documents to judges. That happened under his watch. We can't have people grabbed from their homes and taken to hotels against their will just to force them to testify at trial. That happened under his watch. And at the end of the day, we need a new DA who's going to stand up and keep us safe. But we gotta prosecute these cases with integrity. Mike Vecchione is at the center of many of these wrongful conviction cases. I don't know the man, but I know what fundamental fairness is. It is not fundamentally fair to suppress evidence. It's not fundamentally fair to threaten witnesses as they testified in the Collins case. Joe Hynes is the top prosecutor. It is time for us to have a new DA. A DA who's going to make sure that innocent people don't go to prison and make sure that we have new ways. We have to go in a new direction. We cannot afford four more years of this failed leadership. That is a fact. Now, I present myself to you, and I have a record. He says I don't. I have a record. Whether you like it, what I did in the DSK case or other cases, I stood up. There's a common theme. And do you know how hard it was for me to get from the projects of New York City to where I am today? No one gave me anything. I had a mother who didn't give up on me. I had a mother who fought to give me a better life. And I want to fight to give these young people a better life. When you see these young guys walking around with their pants hanging down, I want them to know that I was once one of them as a young boy. That they don't have to do that. That if I can come out of the projects raised by a single mother and do what I've done, they can do great things. And so we need to have a new DA who's going to be fair. And Joe Hynes has been in office long enough, and it's time for a new DA. And I hope you will vote for me, and let's take Brooklyn in a new direction. Thank you.
I don't plan to use my time to try and rebut the scurrilous, unsupported attack on the integrity of Mike Vecchione, who convicted and sent to jail the county chairman of the Kings County Democratic Committee, and convicted and sent to jail two corrupt judges. But Judge Dora Irizarry knew damn well, and she was told by Detective Jerry Satano, that Vecchione was not the person who violated the Brady law. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about my upbringing, how tough it was for me as a child to watch my mother being beaten up, and were it not for her and getting me counseling, I don't know where the hell I would be. So I didn't come from the projects, but I came from the nightmare of domestic violence, and I've done something about that. I have many things planned for the next term if I'm lucky enough to get it. Most recently, I was approached by the Women's Prison Association. Would I be the prosecutor in New York City?